Good afternoon. My name is Sylvia Smith, and I'm the Washington editor of the Fort Wayne Journal-Gazette, and I'm president of the National Press Club. We're the world's leading professional organization for journalists, and on behalf of our 3,500 members worldwide, I'd like to welcome our speaker and our guests in the audience today. I'd also like to welcome those of you who are watching on C-SPAN or listening on XM Satellite Radio. We're celebrating our 100th anniversary this year, and we've rededicated ourselves to a commitment to a future of journalism through informative programming, journalism education, and fostering a free press worldwide. For more information about the Press Club, please visit our website at www.press.org. We're looking forward to today's speech, and afterward, I'll ask as many questions from the audience as time permits. Please hold your applause during the speech so that we have as much time for questions as possible. I'd like to explain that if you do hear applause, it may be from the guests and members of the general public who attend our luncheons, not necessarily from the working press, a caveat I usually say about politicians. I'd now like to introduce our head table guests and ask them to stand briefly when their names are called. From your right, Jonathan Salant, a reporter with Bloomberg News and a past president of the Press Club. Mary Lou Donahue, producer, editor, and host of Artistically Speaking. Tammy Lytle, a freelancer and another past president of the National Press Club. Nasa Condamita, a producer of the Washington Bureau at Azteca Americana Television. Jeff Dufour, columnist with the Washington Examiner. Edward London, business advisor to Billy Joel and one of our speaker's guests. Angela Gryling Keene of Bloomberg News and chairwoman of the Speaker's Committee, and we'll skip over our speaker for just a minute. Andrew Schneider, associate editor of Kiplinger Washington Editors and organizer of today's luncheon. Thank you very much, Andrew. Lee Eastman of Eastman & Eastman, one of our speaker's guests. Maureen Grappi, Gannett News Service and Secretary of the National Press Club. Eleanor Herman, an author. And Arlen Withers, a consultant. Welcome, everyone. Anyone who needs an introduction to today's speaker has probably not listened to the radio for the past four decades. It would be hard to overstate the impact Billy Joel has had on popular music, both as a performer and a composer. He has shown his versatility in music, ranging from ballads and love songs, to hard-driving rock, to classical piano. In his songs, he has spoken to topics ranging from the plight of factory communities, commercial fishermen and Vietnam veterans, to the broad sweep of the baby boomers' life experience. His concert touring schedule would exhaust even the most seasoned foreign correspondent. In 1987, he became the first U.S. rock star to bring a full production to the Soviet Union. In the past 2 years alone, he has played to capacity crowds in the United Kingdom, Ireland, Italy, South Africa, Australia, and Japan, not to mention audiences across the U.S. And to cap his diplomatic career, he can now forever claim the mantle of the only artist to play both Yankee Stadium and Shea Stadium. Between recording and touring, he has given generously of his time and talents in support of a plethora of worthy causes: the environment, troubled farmers, music education, famine relief, disaster relief, soldiers in the field, and the victims of the 9/11 attacks. For his work, he has been widely and justly honored. 16 of his albums have gone platinum or multi-platinum, with U.S. sales of a million or more. He is the winner of 6 Grammy Awards, including the prestigious Grammy Legend Award for his ongoing contributions in the recording field. He was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1999 and given a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame in 2005. His record 12 sold-out concert at New York's Madison Square Garden earned him the first retired number, that is 12, by a non-athlete in that arena's history. And Washington, too, has recognized his contributions. In 2000, the Smithsonian Institution awarded him with the James Smithson Bicentennial Medal of Honor. Fame does not exist in a vacuum, though. Achieving and sustaining it requires people who spread the word of who you are and what you've accomplished. That can sometimes lead to a rocky relationship between a celebrity and the press, particularly when coverage steps over the line from career to private life. Our guest has had his share of such treatment, but members of the media have also had an undeniably positive effect on his life. They range from Press Club member Llewellyn King, a friend of our guest family since the early 1960s, to his wife Katie Lee, a chef and regular contributor to the Huffington Post. Please join me in giving a warm National Press Club welcome to the piano man, Billy Joel.
Thank you. Thank you.
Do you guys want to shoot all the time, or you just want to... Why don't you stand up so we don't have the chin shot? You know what I mean? stand up and shoot right at me. Yeah. Okay. No, really, because it's going to be, you know, one big chin shot. No? Okay, well, whatever. Anyway, thank you for that intro. I was wondering why you guys wanted me here. And now I know, I guess. Actually, it was three stadiums. We forgot Giant Stadium.
So
it was,
sorry.
It's okay. No, it's the hat trick. We did the hat trick. I didn't really come prepared with a speech. This is the first time I was asked to speechify here. I did have an idea. I was trying to think of something timely for the press, especially in Washington, D.C. The premise that I thought I might try to talk about, which would be timely now, was going to be why I have studiously avoided political endorsements in my career.
Oops.
And yeah, a week ago, I did a fundraiser for one of the presidential candidates, and I kind of blew that one out of the water. So it might be something that comes up in a question. But anyway, I'm not going to get up on a soapbox here. I am a piano player. And not all that good, despite what people might think. The guy in the lobby is probably a better pianist than I am. I happen to be able to figure out how to write songs, and I can sing in key when I try. And since we only have an hour, I might as well just jump right to the questions.
So well,
that's my speech. That was it.
It's a brilliant speech. Thank you.
Vote for me. Keep it short.
We can tell you're not a politician. But you are a celebrity, and as you pointed out, celebrities often involve themselves in the political process. Except for the fact that you did do that concert on behalf of Obama. Tell me a little bit about your thinking about celebrities who involve themselves in electoral politics.
Well, I was asked to do a fundraiser, and I've never discuss my political views to an audience. You know, people pay for tickets. I don't think they want to hear what you, who you're going to vote for, or what, you know, how you think they should vote. I don't know. I get insulted when I'm at a show and somebody starts talking to me about political stuff and says, "Oh, I didn't come here to hear that song." You know, it's in a way it's condescending. You know, my policies have been my own in the sanctity of the voting booth, but over the last few months, you know, there's a quote that keeps occurring to me, and it's a Dante quote. It says, "The darkest places in hell are reserved for those who maintain their neutrality in times of moral crisis." And I thought, oh, okay. All righty. I don't want to be in that place. So I did this fundraiser, but you know, it's bad for business too. You know, half your audience may disagree with you, and then I'm not going to come see him again. Hell with him. So, you know, your political views. And there's also the, what if I'm wrong? What if I'm wrong? It's possible. It's possible. I could be wrong. And if someone is not, hasn't decided, is weak-minded enough to allow me to make the decision for them, then we got a real problem. What is that, Groucho Marx, to anybody who would want me as a member of their club I don't want to belong to in the first place? So there's a little bit of that. Anyway, so that's how I feel about that stuff.
Some of your songs, like Goodnight Saigon, are quite political in their message. What's the one song of yours that you feel is most political in its message and meaning? Maybe you play a bar or two.
You know, in a way, everything's political. I mean, mm-hmm. Look, love is political. There's a lot of politics involved with relationships. It's politics with friendships. It's politics with family. I don't know when we're ever not being political. Overtly political, having to do with geopolitics, would probably... There was a song called Leningrad, which was written about an encounter I had with a guy in Russia when we were in the Soviet Union. For me, the Cold War ended when I met this guy. He was a clown in a circus, and he made my daughter laugh. He was doing things to make her laugh, and I realized, I said, I'm not going to fight with these people. We're not going to have a war with these people. The Cold War ended for me right then. I wrote a song about it. And I took some liberties with dates and stuff, but I wanted to kind of encompass the Cold War, which was the defining geopolitical climate in my lifetime, was the Cold War. It amazed me to this day that there's a lot of younger people who don't even know what I'm talking about. But I remember hiding under the desk, waiting for the mushroom cloud, and the teacher would say, okay, if you hide under the desk and you put your hands over your head, and we all thought, kiss your ass goodbye. That's really going to stop that radiation from burning us all up. We knew when we were children, and we were terrified about the potential of a nuclear war. And that was my way of addressing that particular situation. I know there's a song, We Didn't Start the Fire, which a lot of school children learned. And that wasn't really an attempt to write a political song. That was just a bunch of headlines and a terrible melody. That's an example of writing the lyrics first, because I usually write the music first, but the melody goes like this. Terrible melody.
You're right, it does sound much better with the lyrics.
Well, the lyrics, you get away with a lot when you can throw a whole bunch of lyrics into a song. And 49 to 89, and I realized I was running out of time, and I jumped through the 70s in like three sentences, and that was it. But I'm not really trying to write a political song when I write these kinds of things. I'm trying to talk about people. Even the song you mentioned, Goodnight Saigon, was about my friends who had gone to Vietnam. They asked me to write this song, and I said, I can't write a song about Vietnam. I wasn't there. And they said, we'll tell you what happened to us. We'll tell you what to write, and you write it. And I realized the definitive novel about the Civil War was written by a man who wasn't even in the war. His name was Stephen Crane, The Red Badge of Courage. And I said, well, I guess maybe it can be done. And we sat down and we talked. And really what I wanted to talk about was how people felt, what the situations people found themselves in, real human beings, how they react to things, how they feel, how they respond. And I never really tried to sit down and write, I'll write a political barn burner now. I never thought like that.
Tell me a little more about that conversation or series of conversations you had with your friends. What kind of questions did you weren't in Vietnam. What kind of questions did you ask them? How did you draw them out?
Well, they had never really been welcomed home. There weren't a lot of parades. There wasn't a lot of celebration when these guys came back. We were all the same age. And they went through a terrible time coming home and trying to make that adjustment from the trauma of war to normal life again. And they really never got the welcome they should have gotten. They put their lives at stake, and some of them didn't come back. And we spent the night, I took notes. I was listening to them, what they were saying. And they, it wasn't about what was wrong and what was right. It wasn't about what was America and what was Vietnam. It was about you and your friends, trying to hold on to each other and trying to survive. And at the time, it was all about us against them, just to be able to stay alive. And it's hard for us who haven't been through, tempered by war, to understand, how the basic survival, how much basic survival is, how much you depend on each other and your comrades in arms. And that's what struck me the most about that.
Jump forward then to last year when you wrote Christmas in Fallujah. How would you contrast those two songs and the experiences of writing those two songs?
Well, I just thought it was strange that I found that we were involved in another war again. There were young people being sent off to a foreign land to risk their lives, and some of them weren't going to come back. I didn't sing that song. I made a demo of it when I wrote it, and I heard my voice, and when I wrote it, I was 58 years old, and I said, nah, it can't be a 58-year-old guy singing this song. It's got to be somebody about 19 or 20, a soldier's age. And my guitar player had been working with a younger artist, and we asked him to come in and sing the song. I said, that's the voice. That's the voice. I actually did want to try to help somebody else's career. I've had a lot of success in the recording industry and hit records, although I have to give Columbia Records the credit because I wouldn't pick a hit if it bit me in the butt. I have no idea. I hand in an album, I do an album's worth of material, I give it to the record company, I say, here, now it's your turkey, you figure it out. And then they do their study groups and their demographic focus stuff and hocus pocus, and then they come up with this one they want for the singles. People think I'm picking these things. I ain't picking them. They're picking them. So I got to give them credit. Columbia's got a lot of good hit pickers.
What's been the reaction of Iraq veterans to that song? I mean, do you have a sense of that?
There was an appreciation by some people. Some people didn't like it. Some people took offense. Some people, you know, just said, "Well, you have a right to express how you feel." Some people appreciated it. Mm-hmm. It was all over the place.
Well, talk about those hit pickers. What would you have chosen? What's an example of a song that you didn't think would be a hit besides this one? And ones
Oh, Piano
you,
Man.
Yeah, you didn't?
I don't think Piano Man would be a hit.
Really?
It's a waltz. It's in 6/8 time, mm-hmm. where you can waltz to it. And, you know, there's a harmonica and... It's kind of a limerick more than a lyric. John at the bar is a friend of mine. He gets him a drinks for free. He's quick with a joke. A lot of you smoke with somebody to be. There once was a girl from Nantucket. Had no idea that this would be a hit single, and it wasn't like anything else on the radio. And you know, it's funny. I walk into a lobby in a hotel or a restaurant where there's a pianist. And they recognize me, and I'm like the, you know, the patron saint, the piano bar guys. So they, and they start playing this song, you know. And I'm thinking to myself, he doesn't realize the song doesn't go anywhere. And thank God for that little part that goes. And then I look at him and go. So I'm as surprised as anyone. I think all of them, I've been surprised at every record that was a hit. Uptown Girl, some people can't stand me for that song. I'm just trying to sound like Frankie Valli in the Four Seasons. Uptown Girl, she's been living in her up, like somebody's got a hold of your, you know. my Uptown Girl. And it was kind of an homage, but kind of a tongue-in-cheek homage to Frankie Valli in the Four Seasons. You know, they had a song called Rag Doll. Like, the guy was the rich guy, and the girl, when she was just a kid, her clothes were hand-me-down. Rag Doll, ooh. And I said, okay, I'll flip it the other way around. Now, I'm the guy, the downtown guy. She's the uptown girl. And it became a hit. It became a hit record. It's kind of a joke. I'm surprised at any of them being hits, honestly.
Is this a commentary on American kids' taste?
I think it's airplay. Yeah, you play something enough on the radio, people are going to get used to it or like it or want it or it's airplay. It's
like political ads.
Any ad. What do you know, like, who's that guy, Billy Mays? Billy Mays! I have to turn the TV volume off. It comes, Billy Mays, buy this money! Shut up! But they keep hiring the guy, so they must be buying this stuff. You know, if there's enough airplay, you know, people, they just want to buy it.
Okay. Well, somebody's desperate to ask this question. What's the story behind Still Rock and Roll to Me, or does it speak to itself? And then in giant Billy Mays voice, play it!
Well, that's kind of hard to do on a piano. It's a guitar song, like that.
There you go.
On a piano, it's... doesn't really make it. What's the story behind Still Rock and Roll to Me? I don't even think there is one. What's the matter with the clothes I'm wearing? Can't you tell that your tie's too wide? The chord progression might sound familiar. Lay, 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 lay. Lay across my big brass bed. What's the matter with the clothes I'm wearing? Can't you tell that your tie's too wide? Stay, lady, stay. Stay while the night is still ahead. I'm gonna get sued by Bob now. But, it was just a commentary on, the changing fashions. The more things change, the more they stay the same. Mm-hmm.
Well, that brings up a variation of many questions that we have about your influences, people who've been influences on you. This one says, you've listed some of your own musical influences, such as Beethoven, the Beatles, Ray Charles, Pete Seeger, Jackson Brown, the Rolling Stones, Wilson Pickett, Gordon Lightfoot, Elvis Presley, and I'm sure more. You've played with some of these greats over the year. Which musician was the most rewarding for you to perform or collaborate with?
Ooh. Wow, I don't want to leave anybody out. Ray Charles was probably the single most intense recording session I ever did. I heard that he wanted to do a recording with me. He worked with Quincy Jones, who was a friend of my producer, Phil Ramone, and the word came back, Ray would like to do something with you. And I said, fantastic, Ray Charles, my idol. What can I write? What am I going to write about? And my daughter had just been born around the same time. And they go, what do I have in common with Ray Charles? I'm this little nebbish from Levittown. He's this African-American man from Georgia. What are we going to have in common? And I thought, the piano. I just had a baby grand. Okay, so I wrote this song called Baby Grand. And I'm waiting on pins and needles to hear if he likes the song. What if he doesn't like it? Or if Ray doesn't like it? Ray hates it. Oh, what did I do? I really let myself, I can get crunched by this guy. And he gives a call, Mr. Charles on the phone. I said, Mr. Charles, what do you think? I like it. I want to do the song. He likes it. Yeah. He likes my kid, you know. And I'm in the recording studio. This was a very expensive recording session, entire orchestra, Los Angeles rhythm section, bass guitarist, drum, two pianos, video crews, dive bombers, everything. I mean, it was a very expensive Hollywood recording session. And I'm sitting there, waiting, and in walks Ray Charles. And it's like you're seeing the Washington Monument walk in. And I said, he's actually going to do this. How am I going to do this? I was kind of like paralyzed with fear. How are we going to get over it? And we played the piano. Phil Ramone had a great idea. He said, look, to break the ice, instead of trying to sing right at Ray Charles and him singing right at you and you're getting intimidated, why don't you relate as musicians? And we played, and here's what Ray has, he's got these great blues chops, and I just played the basic chords. And Ray was going. And we just started having a dialogue as musicians, as piano players, which was what the song was about anyway. Late at night, when I'm stuck and cold, I'll reach out for someone to hold. When I'm blue, when I'm lonely, she comes through. She's the only one who can. My baby grand.
is all I need. And then Ray kicks in. Yeah, my time has wandered everywhere around this world. Hey, she would always be there any day, any hour. All it takes is the power in my hand. This baby Grant's been good to me, and then went on from there.
And it worked out. We were able to, I was able to break the ice with him just by playing the piano, and then he started singing, and he was doing Ray, and I said, well, I'll throw in a little Ray myself. And by the time we got to the end, we were just having a blast. The most recent thing I did with someone, we played at Shea Stadium. And those of you who know the history of Shea know that the first rock and roll concert done in a stadium was done by the Beatles in 1965. So here we are, we're at Shea Stadium, and ended up there, we did two nights at Shea. We were thinking, what do we call it? Touche, Shea Goodbye. You know, the booking agents, they always like to have a name for something. So we said, okay, the last play at Shea. Then it turns out, a lot of people got aced out of tickets by scalpers, so we added another night. Now the people who thought they got, you know, the only night at Shea are like, oh, they're all bugging, and it's, oh, you can't please everybody, what are you gonna do? So we were gonna call it the last play at Shea, and then I thought, okay, well, what are we gonna, the last double play at Shea, and people are still bugged. But the second night, we had lined up some guest artists to come to Shea, John Mellencamp, Don Henley, Tony Bennett, Steven Tyler from Aerosmith, Roger Daltrey, Mellencamp, I said, who? Garth Brooks, John Mayer. Well, look, at the end of the show, somebody comes up and goes, Paul's here, the second night. And I said, Paul? Yeah. Paul. And he comes on stage, and he's got that left-handed Hofner bass that he got out of the Smithsonian. I don't know how he pulled this together. And he walks on stage, and it's, you know, Paul McCartney, the Beatle guy. Like, and at the end of the night, we, you know, usually we'd end with Piano Man. I said, no, you end it. What do you want to end with? And he said, Let It Be. And he said, of course. And it looked like we planned it all, but it was completely spontaneous. We had no idea this was going to happen. So that was an intense collaboration.
Are there any musicians that you would dearly love to perform with that you haven't had an opportunity to perform with?
I've had some terrific opportunities to work with other musicians. I just did a show with Springsteen a week ago. That was a hoot. I had to learn his stuff. He had to learn my stuff. I'm trying to sing like Bruce, and he's trying to sing like me, and we had to kind of deconstruct each other's material. A guy I haven't worked with yet who I would dearly love to work with is Eric Clapton. I think he's a terrific musician, and he's just got such a great technique on guitar. That would be someone I would like to work with eventually.
If you could bring any musician back from the dead to play with, who would it be?
To play with, or just to bring a musician back from the dead?
Nah, to play with.
To play with,
to
probably
collaborate with.
Jimi Hendrix,
yeah.
I think. Yeah, I love Hendrix. To collaborate with it. I actually tried to write songs like Hendrix. I'll show you. I had this idea for a song, and I was thinking of Hendrix.
Well, I'm shameless when it comes to loving you. I'll do anything you want me to. I'll do anything at all, yeah. Well, I'm standing here for all the wine. I'm picturing bleep, 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 bleep,
electric Ladyland kind of guitar. Bleep, 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 bleep. And then Garth Brooks does the song, and he does it like a cowboy.
Well, I'm shameless
when it, and he makes it a hit. So Which is great. I never considered the song being a country western song, but he had a hit with it. But I would say Jimmy. I would also like John Lennon. I would love to have done something with John Lennon. Mm-hmm. Terrific songwriter. Oh, there's so many of them. If I was going to bring back one musician, I would bring back Beethoven.
Yeah.
But it probably wouldn't get along with him, you know?
I don't
understand he couldn't get along with anybody very well.
Do you know Sign?
Do I know Sign?
Yeah. So what would be the question you would ask?
Everybody in New York signs.
That's true. What would be the question you'd ask him?
Beethoven?
Yeah.
Oh, what would I ask him? There's just too many things I would ask him. The Third Symphony, which was this revolutionary, it was an ode to Napoleon Bonaparte originally. It's a famous symphony, the Eroica, you know. Which is like a trumpet call. Everybody was thrilled with Napoleon at the time because he was going to knock off all the kings and all the aristocrats, and the American Revolution inspired all these artists in Europe at the time. And then Bonaparte, he crowns himself emperor. So Beethoven had written this whole symphony, the Bonaparte Symphony, and he's so furious that this guy who was his hero turned himself into being an emperor. He was going to rip up the symphony, and then he starts to rip the title page. He goes, I'll just rip the title page up, and he calls it the Eroica. So I would have liked to have asked him, like, so really, how'd you feel when the guy put the crown on his head? Did you end it different? Did you decide to put in a different movement? Yeah, there's a lot of questions I'd like to ask him.
Somebody wants to know, says you performed a memorable duet with Tony Bennett. Did you ever get the chance to meet or perform with Frank Sinatra?
I met Frank Sinatra. I got a letter from Frank Sinatra, which I have in my office. And it says, I had done an interview where I was talking about singing. And I said, Frank Sinatra is a singer who phrases like a great saxophone player phrases his sax part. And Frank wrote me a note, thanks for the kind words. And if you ever have 16 bars laying around that you don't want to record, send them to me. And I said, Frank Sinatra wants me to write a song for him. And then he passed away. I only got to meet him once. It was in Australia. And there's this hotel in Sydney, Australia, the Park Hyatt. And everybody wants to get this one room at the Park Hyatt because it's got a beautiful view of the bridge. And Frank got the room. We were playing like 10 nights at this venue. Frank was playing like one night, but he got the room. So I'm not going to argue. It's Frank. You know, you don't argue with Frank. Frank wants the room. Frank gets the room. So his wife, Barbara, is down in the lobby. She goes, come on up, Billy. He'd love to see you. He's doing a show tonight in Brisbane. Come on up to the room. He'd love to see us. Well, okay, we go up to the room and there's all this food, antipasto and pepperoni and, you know, vino and all this stuff. And we were just hanging around picking at the food. And he'll be here any minute. Again, he comes in and he's not happy with the show in Brisbane. He comes in the door and he goes, who the hell are these people? So we look at Barbara, maybe we should go. It's probably not a good time. No, it's okay. We'll just have a little chat. And they go in the room next door, and you hear glasses breaking, smash, boom, yelling and screaming. Like, maybe we should go. It's not a good time. So she said, no, hang out. It's going to be fine. He just wasn't feeling it that night. But the next night, he was down in the bar. I didn't go down there, but my ex number two, Christy, was there, and she's ex two. He's down in the bar, and he's feeling pretty good. Christy Brinkley, dooby dooby dooby, Christy Brinkley. And they're calling me up from the bar. Brian, you remember this, my sound boy. He's down in the bar, he's singing to Christy. Yeah, sure he is. You know, so I never got to follow up, but I would have liked to.
Yeah, I bet. Well, you mentioned the room that he got that you didn't get, the big one. How do musicians compete with each other? What What do you do that gives you a little rush when you do it better or different than somebody else?
You know what? It's really not a matter of better. I don't think it's a competition like who somebody wins and somebody loses. Yeah. It's fun to spark off another musician's energy and to work with somebody and get a completely different dynamic of how to do something. Everybody's got their own dynamic. Everybody's got their own energy. And that's what's the most fun is like playing with Bruce the other day. It's like, oh, wow, that's a kind of a guitar player's way of doing it. Or on stage, he'll like stop and he'll go, let's do a song, let's do a record, come on, Billy, do it. What's that song? Here it's in the night, all right. I don't even know how it goes. But I winged it. You know, he does a lot of winging and improvising, and there's a lot of spontaneity with a good musician. I work with Elton, and Elton sometimes will just go off on a tangent, and you kind of go with him, and it's like going on a journey, like a magical voyage. Hey, where are we going? I don't know. Just go with him. He's the senior partner. We'll stay with it, you know? So.
It's really the senior partner.
Well, he's the senior partner. You don't want to get into an argument with Elton. He gets all huffy and.
How's that go?
He'll admit it. You know, he has a hissy fit. Yeah. And he's got that English way of doing it, which. Okay, fine. Yeah.
We've got some questions about the evolution in your career, the changes in your career from rock and roll and country influences and classical. How have your fans reacted, particularly as you're doing more classical music?
They're not thrilled with it. You know, I really never have tried to second guess what an audience wants. I don't write for fans. I write for me. I don't write for the record company. I don't write for the radio. I don't write for critics. I write for me, or I'll write a song to a friend, or I'll write a song to a woman I'm in a relationship with, or a woman I want to be in a relationship with, because that always, it works great. It's incredible. Yeah. Yeah, I just
ended up. So which songs were love poems? Which songs were courting songs?
Oh, most of them. Yeah, it was all about, you know, meeting girls. I remember the first gig I ever did, I played at a church dance. I was about 14 or 15, and I'm playing with these other guys in a band, and this girl who I had a crush on, her name was Virginia, by the way. It was the Come Out Virginia, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
That was, she was looking at me, the first time she ever looked at me, and I said, she's looking at me, this is working, this is cool. And then at the end of the night, the priest gives us each like $15, which in 1964 was like $1,500. And you go, you mean you get paid for this? Then that was it. I was in. You know, it's a great way of communicating with people. Music is, it's been a terrific way to live your life.
So is it, describe to me the differences in writing
lyrics.
Are
these questions written down or are you just winging this?
Describe for me the differences. I'm winging it. I'm winging it. I forgot about them.
This is the press. You can't fool them.
But tell me the differences between writing lyrics as a young, struggling artist and a rich, older guy.
Well, I haven't written any lyrics in about 15 years.
Seriously,
I'm too rich, I'm too old.
Are you serious? I mean, how does that affect the creative process?
I can't speak for everybody. I can just speak for me. I got to a point where I kind of grew tired of the song form. I became more comfortable with writing in a more abstract form. I don't want to call it classical music. Let's call it instrumental music for the sake of giving it a name. I felt like, you know, rock and roll, pop music, those kind of records, they're all short. You have to jam it all in within 3.5 minutes. You know, you go longer than 3.5, 4 minutes, you're kind of out of the box. Nobody's going to hear it. They won't play it on the radio. And the attention span of people seems to have changed drastically. I want to see where I can go with this piece of music. I don't just want to jam it all into 3 minutes. I want to try to do some variations on it. I want to see how I can expand on it. Where will it take me? Where will I go? And it ended up, I ended up writing more instrumental music. Most of it people haven't heard. I don't play it very well. I can write it, but I can't play it. Some of it may end up being orchestral music. Some of it may end up being movie soundtrack music. And some of it might end up being songs. I have no idea. It's just, for me, it's important that I'm just writing. That's all.
Somebody wants to know, what's the motivation for writing the song Moving Out, and how did you like the Broadway experience?
Okay, well, the song came way before the Broadway show. I started to write a song. This is interesting. I wrote this song, and I wrote lyrics for it. I first write the music. I always write music first. And then I came up, and then I wrote a whole lyric to it, which is kind of the backwards way of songwriting. Usually, people have a poem, and they set it to music. I write the other way around. I write a piece of music, and then I jam words on top of the notes. So I wrote this song, and you'll recognize what melody this was. Anthony works in the grocery store, saving his pennies for someday. Mama Lee only left a note on the door. She said, "Sonny, move out to the country." Ooh, I hear laughter in the rain. And the band says, "That's Laughter in the Rain by Neil Sedaka, you idiot." I didn't write the Laughter in the Rain part. I just wrote the... You mean I wrote a whole lyric? And now I can't use it? So I got really ticked off, and I said, okay, I'll write another lyric, another piece of music. Anthony works in the grocery store, saving his pennies for someday. Mama Lee only left a note on the door. I wasn't going to throw away a whole lyric after I killed myself writing it. So I finished the song, and it became called Moving Out. Twyla Tharp comes to me, and she says, I want to do a dance show based on your music. And I said, okay. Sounded like it could be a complete catastrophe. It appealed to the perverse sense of, you know, wire walking that I like to do. I said, this could be an abysmal failure, and I just, let's go, let's do it. I got that thing, okay, this could be horrific, great. And she showed me some choreography she had done to my songs. She had picked up all these inner rhythms, counter rhythms, syncopations that musicians use when they're writing and had put it into dance. And I didn't know how people were going to respond to it, but I was never like a guy who went to the ballet all the time, you know? I saw a ballet when I was a kid, and okay, all righty. I like the music. I don't get what they're doing. But she was able to bring all that stuff out of the music with dance. So that was a thrill. People have asked me, what's the extent of my collaboration with Twyla Tharp? I said, go ahead. I was like, go right ahead. And she had the vision. She did all the work. The only thing I insisted on was that the guys playing on Broadway would be rock and roll musicians, not a standard Broadway pit band. I wanted real road dogs to play this stuff. I didn't want it to sound like, you know, cocktail lounge music. And that was it. And she really put it all together. She did it all. I just said yes. Easy.
Would you be open to another Broadway production involving your music? Or do you have something in mind? Would you ever do one yourself, write music for something like that?
I thought about doing a show based on the premise that death is a good career move in the music industry. It was called, you know, good career move. What are the record labels going to do with these artists? You know, Michael Jackson, he's fooling around with kids and stuff. And Prince won't give us anything. And this guy's not right. Billy Joel won't write anything. What do we do? And somebody at another record company says, we kill him. You know, it's a black humor. It's a dark comedy. But it's true. You know, there's nothing like death for a career. Elvis, look at Elvis.
Yeah.
You know, boom, he dies, sells gazillions of records. So it was the premise of a show I was going to do, and then I just left it as a premise. I haven't taken it any further than that.
Is there a theme song for that? Got some tunes for it?
Well, it was called Good Career Move.
Yeah.
But haven't written the song yet.
Okay. No. So who's on your iPod?
I don't have an iPod.
Really?
Yeah.
You Luddite?
What's that?
You a Luddite?
A Luddite?
Do you not get up a cozy with modern technology?
No, I'm very 20th century. I'm an analog kind of guy. I listen to CDs and sometimes vinyl. I'm mostly programming classical music.
Beethoven, Chopin, Rachmaninoff, Debussy. It's the stuff I like to listen. I'll listen to the radio if I'm in the car with my wife. Mm-hmm. And actually, her father is here today. Steve Lee. Hey, Steve. How you doing? You young whippersnapper? I'm older than you are. She'll say, all right, let's turn on the car radio and listen to some, you know, modern popular music. And my daughter will do the same thing. She'll say, let's enough with this classical junk. Let's listen to some rock and roll. And that's how I get exposed to new music these days.
Well, I was curious as to why you use a digital piano instead of one with strings.
Well, let's show them, Wayne.
All right.
Where are you, Wayne?
Right over here.
Right over here. Okay. I'll show you. Okay. It's a little inside showbiz bit. Let's do, let's start. New York State of Mind was originally written in the key of C. Let's go to the people's key.
You're there.
Okay. Now, I am 59 years old. I wrote this song when I was 24, 25. And your voice is higher when you're younger, so.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Have a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood.
Now, I'll show you why I use this. He's gonna knock this down.
Some folks like to get away.
I'm playing in the same key.
Take a holiday.
But you're hearing a different key.
Neighborhood. Have a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood.
See, I can drop a whole tone without having to change keys. He just turns a button.
Good, do it again.
All right, change key again. I'm going to hit the same chord. Watch what you hear.
Keep going.
Knock it up again. That's up. That's down. See, that's why I have somebody else do it. That's how technology unfriendly I am. I don't even know how to do that on the piano. I got to have a guy doing it. That's real 20th century. Yeah. You do it.
Well, there is a 21st century question here. One of the biggest issues in the entertainment industry today is the question of intellectual property rights. How do artists continue to own their material in the digital age? And how have these intellectual property developments affected your work? And how do you see the music industry coping with it?
That sounds like a question for my attorney.
Or we could ask
He's
you to
right
play
here.
Another song.
I brought him. You got touring, yeah.
Touring.
That's it's very difficult to protect intellectual property now. It's so easily disseminated. But I understand it. You know, kids, they can get something for nothing, that's how they're going to get it. I think the music business actually got very, very greedy and priced itself right out of the business. There's some little kid, some little rat somewhere figuring out how to beat the system. It's always going to be like that. They're gnawing away at the machine. And if we can get it for nothing, that's how we're going to get it. And I think in a way that's reflected in a lot of modern songwriting right now. If you're not going to get paid for it, then you're not going to really devote your whole life to doing it. You got to make a few quid, you know what I mean? So I think people have found it not to be as lucrative as it used to be, and that's what we're getting right now. We're getting kind of crap.
Is there anybody who's writing good?
Oh, there's many, many talented people out there. I don't know how much exposure they get. Uh-huh. There's a lot of good artists. There'll always be good people who have talent, who know how to do it well, but they should be compensated for it. If your ability to earn your living, you know, based on your craft is taken away from you, what's going to happen to the craft? So, how's that for?
Okay. Perfect.
Just got to check with my attorney.
Questioner says, which song is most technically challenging to perform live, and which one is the most emotionally challenging? Although, having done them many, many times, do you still have an emotional reaction to the songs you're performing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Probably the most challenging songs for me to do emotionally are the songs... there's a lullaby I wrote for my daughter, and I can't think about the lyric when I'm... I can't. I have to, like, look at people in the Coliseum going to the bathroom. Really, and just like, don't think about these lyrics because you're going to lose it. Because I wrote the song my marriage was coming apart, and I was worried, when am I going to see my kid? And I wrote the song for her to let her know, I will never leave you, I'll always be there. And I'm singing, and I'm thinking, I'm remembering writing the song, and I can't think of the lyrics. I have to look at people going to the bathroom, and while I'm saying the lyric, and get mad at the people going to the bathroom, so I don't think about what I really was feeling when I wrote the song, otherwise I'll lose it. So that's a little inside showbiz thing. We do things like that. I'm thankful that people do go to the bathroom during that song, or else I'd be able to get through it. Where's he going? And then the technically most challenging. I don't know, Brian. What do you think is the technically? Where's Brian? You're up in the booth? He's my sound man. He's been with me 40, 50, 60 years now. What's the most technically challenging? What do you think? Yeah, because I can't hit those notes anymore. People want to know why we don't do Uptown Girl. They think it's because I'm mad at Christy or I'm mad at X2. It's because it's a pain in the ass to sing it. Uptown Girl, you're my Uptown Girl. Is that the people's key, Wayne?
Yeah.
Already I'm out of my range. Uptown, you have to sing it like at the edge of your voice. You have to really push your voice and scream it out. Uptown girl. See? She's been living in her uptown world. I bet she never had a backstreet guy. I bet her mama never told her why. I'm gonna try like Frankie Valli. But after that song, I can't sing any other songs. Like, you have to shred your voice. Elton used to do it, but he would do it. He lowered the key.
Uptown girl, she been living in her uptown.
That's too low. It sounds terrible that low. But technically, you can do it.
There's a little baby in the audience with a tuxedo on. He's just a couple months old. He wants to know, what songs did you sing your kid to sleep?
Oh, well, let's see.
There's the baby.
What songs did I sing my daughter? So many songs. Sometimes they weren't even songs. They were just melodies that were, you know, you sing loo-loo-loo, 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 rock-a-bye and good-night. What's the other? The famous Brahms lullaby. How does that go? I'd play the piano,
yeah.
And that put her to sleep. Yeah.
Yeah.
It works with girls, the piano thing. I don't know what it is.
Well, talking about your daughter, she's grown up to be a critically acclaimed rock blues singer herself. What's it like for you to follow her career and seeing her enter the music business?
There's a Yiddish word. It's called kvelling. You know the word? Some Yiddish words, you just can't replace them, like kvetch and schlep. Mishigas and Tsuris and Verklempt and Kvelling. I see my kid and I'm like, that's my baby, that's my kid. I get very, very proud, and I'm always a little bit nervous before she goes on. And then she steps up to the plate and just knocks out of the plate. And I just start laughing. Oh, of course.
She's mine. That's great. Well, keeping in the familial theme, tell us a bit about your grandfather and how he shaped you as a musician.
Which one? The English one or the German one?
I don't know. Did they both?
Well, the German grandfather was, his name was Carl Joel, and he, my father's father, they were German Jews in the 20s and 30s living in Nuremberg, which is, some of you may know was the headquarters of the Nazi party back then. And he had the most successful mail order textile business in Germany. It was like Sears. And the business was doing great. And they had to leave right around Kristallnacht in 1938. They had to leave Germany. They went to Cuba, and he was a music aficionado. Carl was. He played piano,
And my father learned how to play the piano. My mother's family was English. And my mother was in Gilbert and Sullivan operettas. I learned a lot of Gilbert and Sullivan when I was a kid. You know, Gilbert and Sullivan's...
I am the monarch of the sea, the ruler of the Queen's Navy, whose praise Great Britain loudly chants, and so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts, and so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts, his sisters and his cousins whom he reckons by his dozens and his aunts, for he is a Englishman. For he himself has said it, and it's greatly to his credit that he is a Englishman, that he is a Englishman.
All right. I am the very model of a modern major general. I'm very good at everything but animal and vegetable. Because a man is vegetable, animal and mineral. I am the very model of a modern major general. Whatever the hell.
Now, my mother's parents met at Albert Hall in London at a Gilbert and Sullivan operetta. They went to they went separately and they met each other there. My mother met my father at CCNY in New York in the early 40s at a production of a Gilbert and Sullivan operetta. I think it was The Pirates of Penzance. And so I owe a lot to Gilbert and Sullivan.
You do.
You know. Or else I wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
But her father was an English, very intellectual man, an Englishman who really couldn't hold a job. My mother's mother was the one who did all the work. She was an English nanny. She was always taking care of babies. And my grandfather would hang around with his intellectual friends and play chess and discuss logarithms. I'd hear him chuckling at night. He'd be reading equations. You know, student of Bertrand Russell, all this crazy stuff, but he was the predominant male figure in my life was my mother's father. He's this English happy-go-lucky guy, and he would sing these songs at our parties, these English musical songs. Way did you get that? Embarrassed the hell out of me. But my friends loved it. Get your grandfather out here. Get put the straw hat and the cane, and he'd do that whole bit. You know, the relative that embarrasses you—that's the one your friends like the most, because they love to see you get embarrassed.
Well, we're almost out of time, unfortunately, and before asking the last question, I have a couple of things to tell members of. Let me remind you of our upcoming speakers. Tomorrow we have Dan Hesse, who's the CEO of Sprint. On November 5th, the day after the election, we'll have the party chairman of the Republican and Democratic National Committees. And on November 17th, we have Maren Alsop, who's the musical director at the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra, and we're looking forward to that. Second, let me present to our guest his very own coffee mug, National Press Club coffee mug. And for our last question, I actually have two last questions.
That's good cup of coffee. Cup of Joe.
My last question is, two last questions. Which of your songs would you choose to be the theme song for each presidential campaign, or will you play us one whole song all the way through?
Which song would for each presidential campaign?
Yeah, or pick one. I don't care.
What was the number two?
Play us a song all the way through.
Yeah, that's easier. Okay. I have to look through the master list here. Let's see. What do we got? Okay, this is. Let me see if I can find the thing. I could do that one, but this is a little more. Okay. This is not called Sadness or Euphoria. This is called Summer Highland Falls.
They say that these are not the best of times, but they're the only times I've ever known. And I believe there is a time for meditation in cathedrals of our own. Now I have seen that sad surrender in my lover's eyes, and I can only stand apart and sympathize. For we are always what our situations hand us. It's either sadness or euphoria. So we'll argue and we'll compromise, realize that nothing's ever changed. For all our mutual experience, our separate conclusions are the same. Now we are forced to recognize our inhumanity. A reason coexists with our insanity. Though we choose between reality and madness, it's either sadness or euphoria. Our energies. Perhaps we don't fulfill each other's fantasies. And as we stand upon the ledges of our lives with our respective similarities, it's either sadness or euphoria.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was an absolute delight. Thank you. And we're going to ask everybody to remain seated. And we are adjourned.